Thank you. Thanks for inviting me. Land reform in South Africa at the current time. We're in a big mess, and I think you all know that. So the real question is, how do we get back on track? And I think maybe after this presentation, you'll begin to start thinking about how can we set land reform on a path which will actually see it really addressing real problems rather than just creating wealth for a few people. So my task today, what I've been asked to do, is present a detailed analysis of different land reform policies, showing how they've changed over time since 1994, and in particular focusing on the new policies over the last 4 or 5 years, which the current minister has put in place, and trying to understand their problems and their weaknesses. So I will focus mainly on restitution and redistribution, but of course one has to talk a little bit about land tenure reform as well. So I'll also talk just a bit about farm worker tenure, and also just a little bit about the place of communal tenure reform in the whole scheme of things. So this is a little bit of ground that you've already covered. Where does land reform come from? What is the point of land reform? What is its objective? Land reform has a particular purpose. And if we lose sight of that purpose, we go astray. So the purpose of land reform is to redress land dispossession, most fundamentally. It's to take the history of land dispossession and to undo its effects and to set us on a different path. So we can not understand anything about land reform unless we understand the ways in which people were dispossessed right up to very recently, the ongoing processes which keep them out of the agricultural economy, of the rural economy in general, and therefore what we can do, what measures we can take to undo these things, to address the roots of the problems and set it on the right track. So this is just a map of the former Bantustans. The 13% dispossession took place over a long time. Easy point of reference is 1652, when Jan van Riebeck arrived. It took place over centuries. Of course, we focus a lot on the 1913 and 1936 Land Act, where by law, the African majority was confined to these so-called reserves, or later called Bantustans, the mere 13%. Of course, they were confined there in terms of the rights that they had. That's where people were allowed to hold land rights. People were, the African majority, rural people in general, were needed in the main core of the economy as workers. And of course, they lived across the whole country. In fact, the whole economy of South Africa, as I'm sure you've been discussing in this course, was built on the labor of ordinary people. If there's wealth in society today, it's you and I, all of us, who've created that wealth. It doesn't really belong to the tiny minority who happen to have shares in companies. They've actually appropriated our labor to create that wealth. And of course, this takes place over a long period of time. And because of this notion that Africans could hold land in the reserves where there was custom and where there were chiefs, but we need their labor, so the migrant labor system formed the basis of the development of the industrial economy in South Africa. Of course, in the late 19th and early 20th century, we did have a very productive, small-scale farming sector, what some would call a peasant farming sector. And as historians like Colin Bundy have written us about at great length, this was a very productive sector. In fact, they were more successful than the white farmers to begin with. They outcompeted them, for example, to supply people working on the diamond mines in Kimberley in the 1860s. The African farming sector had to be destroyed by intent, by deliberately, by the actions of government. And at the same time, that government began to provide lots of support through subsidies, protections, development of infrastructure, and so on, to white commercial farmers. So the destruction of the African peasant farming systems went along with building up the white commercial farming sector. And you can't understand either one without understanding the other part of the process. What were the results of dispossession? the so-called reserves, later called bantustans, became places where low-paid migrant workers had to kept their families. They went from there to work on mines and industry as well as on commercial farms. And back home in the reserve, the agricultural production of those people who were left behind, often women, actually helped to subsidize cheap wages on the mines. I'm sure you've discussed this. I'm sure I'm just rehearsing stuff for you. But in other words, once again, wealth was growing up in the formal sector of the economy, dominated by a racial minority, directly at the expense of the majority. The commercial farming sector was also heavily subsidized by government, by the state, up until the mid-1980s. So it was, I mean, it was basically South Africa's got low agricultural potential. Many parts of the country are very dry. Only the eastern half of the country is really good for cropping. And it took a long time to get a productive system of agriculture going in this country. And it depended heavily on state investment and state subsidy. That's actually what's missing at the present time, particularly for new farmers and for land reform beneficiaries. Then we go to the apartheid years, which you've discussed at great length, with many references to personal experience. Forced removals on a massive scale, at least 2.5 million people, probably more, moved from both rural and urban areas defined as white to so-called black areas with all the consequences that followed. So at the end of apartheid, in 1994, when we have our transition to democracy, what's the situation in the countryside? 82 million hectares of commercial farmland owned by 60,000 white farmers, with 13 million African people crowded into the former bantustans. There were also small reserves for colored people in the Western Cape and Northern Cape, often on former mission stations. And of course, there was racial segregation in towns and cities as well. But in the countryside, by this point, by 1994, after many, many decades of state policies which set out to privilege white farming at the expense of black farmers, at that point in time, people had become dependent on their income from migrant work, from going to work in the cities, in factories, and on mines, as well as on commercial farms. So that by the end of the 1980s, the beginning of the 1990s, most rural households did no longer depend on agriculture as their main source of income. And you all know this to be the reality today. At that stage, people would, before we had social grants, people depended on the remittances which the migrant workers sent home. They also depended on wages, largely, and a little bit on some small-scale, food-oriented, subsistence-oriented agriculture, but it wasn't farming was no longer a major source of income. On these private farms, on the 82 million hectares, of course, you also had a lot of farm workers and their dependents, 3 million people altogether, who were poorly paid, had no security of tenure, they lived in very poor conditions. So as a result of these legacies of apartheid, land reform had to be a key set of policies for the new government. Okay, it remains a key set of issues. So when the ruling party goes about campaigning in the elections, they always make a big thing about land reform. We are going to do something about the continuing inequality in land holding. Every year it's trotted out, but we'll see that it hasn't quite worked out that way. How did land reform get onto the agenda of the new democratic government? Partly through struggle, as you've been talking about during the workshop, partly through rural people driving struggles to resist forced removals, people taking on chiefs who were being abusive, who were corrupt. So the struggle was driven by rural people, and they were assisted by NGOs and activists and lawyers and so on, as continues to happen today. So it was really people's struggle which put land reform on the agenda. So what is the key reference point for us in thinking about land reform? Once again, we come back to our democratic constitution, which we fought so hard to achieve. And this is a quote from the property clause, the so-called property clause in the Constitution, okay, section 25, which deals with property rights, it deals with land. This was a controversial section of the Constitution. It was negotiated and bargained over right until the very last moment before the new constitution was adopted. There was the old vested interests, the old guard, were trying to protect their property rights, their land rights. Whereas the progressive forces were trying to say, no, we need to have a fundamental reform. So in that process, there was a compromise struck. And the compromise is the property clause. Okay, so as you know, property is protected on the one hand. On the other hand, so you can't deprive people of property without doing it through the law. And if you deprive people of property in order to redistribute it, you have to pay compensation. The Constitution does not say that you must pay market-based constitution. You don't have to pay the market price. You can take into account a range of other factors, including the history of that land and the history of investment in it and so on, and you can deduct those values from the price which is paid when you buy, when government buys land for land reform. Okay? So on the one hand, property is protected. On the other hand, there are some gains for land reform as well. The Constitution says that when government acquires land for land reform, it is in the public interest. And land reform is defined as in the public interest. So you can expropriate land in the public interest and for land reform, as well as expropriating land for public purposes. For example, if government wants to build a school or a clinic on private land, they can expropriate that land. That's it, for a public purpose. That is common throughout the world. But in South Africa, because of the land struggle leading up to 1994, we now have the possibility of expropriating land and transferring it, redistributing it, as a public, as in the public interest, to justify. So the property clause is a bit of a compromise between different positions. These are the three provisions which create the three different programs of land reform. Section 25.5, which is about redistribution, Section 25.6, which is about land tenure reform, and Section 25.7, which is about restitution. And the programs of land reform are based on these provisions in the Constitution. And actually, that's a very important fact for us, because we can use the Constitution and our commitments as a society to a just and equitable society, we can use the Constitution to hold government to account. So these sets of clauses are very, very important for us. They're very important in litigation, but they're also important in mobilization. So Section 25.5 says the state must take reasonable legislative and other measures within its available resources to foster conditions which enable citizens to gain access to land on an equitable basis. Okay? So the point of it is to put in place measures which allow land to be held on an equitable basis, equally, without this highly skewed racial distribution of land. This is the basis for the redistribution program. And you can see it's not a very strong clause. It doesn't say people have strong rights. But on the other hand, it does say people, citizens must be enabled to gain access to land on an equitable basis. So how do we convert that into a meaningful program of land redistribution? That is the key. This clause has never been used in a court case to date. But it may be that you could use this to actually challenge some of government's land redistribution policies and programs. There has been some talk about that. So that's redistribution. Secondly, Section 25.6, which I'm sure many of you know very well, says that a person or community whose tenure of land is legally insecure as a result of past racially discriminatory laws or practices, is entitled, to the extent provided by an Act of Parliament, either to tenure which is legally secure or to comparable redress. In other words, to compensation, either to other land or other forms of compensation. So this gives South Africans a very strong right to security of tenure, secure rights to their land. And this is a very, very important clause in all our struggles. Section 25.7 is about restitution, and it refers directly to, it's the basis for the law which has been passed, the Restitution Act. It says a person or community dispossessed of property after the 9th of June 1913 as a result of past racially discriminatory laws or practices is entitled, to the extent provided by an Act of Parliament, either to restitution of that property or to equitable redress. That's the basis for restitution claims. Now, both 25.6 and 25.7 give people strong rights. Section 25.5 does not give very strong rights. It just talks vaguely about creating conditions to enable equitable access, which is why it's never been used. But Sections 25.6 and 7 provide very strong bases for people to say, we are not legally legally secure on the land that we live on, the land that we hold. We need to have those rights recognized properly in law, or we were dispossessed after 1913. We have a right to get that land back. Notice that both of those last two clauses talk about an act of parliament. They require an act of parliament to be passed. So the Restitution Act was passed in 1994. With regard to Section 25.6, Security of Tenure, we have some laws. We have the Extension of Security of Tenure Act, which provides some security for people living on the land belonging to others on farms. And we have the Labor Tenants Act. Okay? And we have IPILRA, the Interim Protection of Informal Land Rights Act. We don't really have a proper law which guarantees security of access on communal tenure in areas where custom still informs how people hold land together. So there's that act of parliament in respect of communal tenure is still missing. And government, if it didn't pass the law, could be taken to court to say, where is that act of parliament that the Constitution says you must provide? Okay, so the Constitution was the result of all this bargaining and negotiation, and it provides some pluses. It also provides some protections for the elite who held property, dominated property holding in the past. But it is an important basis. So let's just look a little bit at land restitution. Land restitution allowed just under 5 years for people to lodge claims. The Act was passed in 1994, and it gave people until December 1998 in order to lodge their claim. By the end of 1998, 79,696 claims had been lodged. Of those, nearly 80,000, 88% of them were from people living in urban areas who'd been subject to forced removals through the Group Areas Act and similar legislation, which created separate residential zones for people of different so-called races. However, of the 12% which were rural, those constituted a much larger number of people within those claims. And the reason for that is that one rural claim is lodged often on behalf of a group of people, a community, and can involve hundreds and thousands, and in some cases tens of thousands of individual beneficiaries under one rural land claim. Whereas the urban land claims are always family or individual based. So the 88% are urban, really involve a very small number of people compared to the very large number of people who lodge land claims in rural areas. Okay, now most of the urban claims have been settled, but many of the rural claims have not yet been settled, and they affect very large numbers of people. By 2007, 74,500 claims had been settled, involving 1.2 million beneficiaries. Most of those were urban claims and involved cash compensation. In urban areas, government decided that it was not practical or feasible to give people back the same piece of land. Often it had been built on by others, the value had changed considerably, it would involve too much disruption. So in urban areas, cash compensation is the main form, main way that a restitution claim is settled. It's not the same in rural areas. Okay, in rural areas, people often want their land back, or at least some people in a land claiming community want their actual land back, even if not everybody does. And at some points in the past, government has said, we will not settle any rural claims with cash compensation, which is a little bit problematic because some people actually don't want land rights. They have moved on and they do want cash compensation. On the other hand, large numbers of rural people do want their land back through restitution. So at the current point in time, using figures from government, we estimate that about 30,000 claims out of the nearly 80,000 claims settled by, lodged by 1998 are still to be settled or still to be finalized. This includes a figure of some 20,000 which have apparently been settled, in other words, the decision has been made, but no implementation has yet taken place. They haven't yet been finalized. So they're still hanging. They're still waiting to be implemented. So it's a very large number which over about 20 years, government was not able to resolve. So the main story here is that restitution has been very, very slow. Okay? And, yeah, so we have to recognize that it is expensive. Some claims cost hundreds of millions of rands for government to purchase the farm in order to deliver it back. It takes a big chunk of the land reform budget, which is not a simple thing to resolve, and there have been many other problems as well. The other part of the policy was that if, when people were getting land back through land restitution as a group, as a community, they had to form an institution in order to represent them, to hold the land on their behalf. They had to form either a communal property association, a CPA, through a special 1996 act, which we put in place after 1994, or people could form a landholding trust using old legislation. And this allows people to hold land in private ownership as a group. Okay? It was unfortunate that the trust option was decided because trusts are supposed to be overseen by the master of the court. And the master of the court cannot do that. On their own admission, they do not have the capacity to oversee the functioning of trusts or the establishment of trusts. And so trusts are not governed, are not overseen by government in any way whatsoever. And all sorts of things happen in the trust. With CPAs, government, the Act says that government must support these new institutions, must help them to get established, must make sure that they lodge annual reports with financial accounts, and that they must receive help if they have problems. Now, on that, in that respect, government has completely failed the CPAs. Very little real support has been offered to CPAs, and many of them do, in fact, have real problems. Not all CPAs are run democratically. In some cases, educated people run them for their own benefit, and ordinary people lose out. In other cases, people just don't know what they should do to solve their problems, and they get very little real support. In fact, the establishment of CPAs and trusts has been highly problematic. Often, an external service provider was brought in to do it on behalf of a community or a group of people. And these consultants, whether they were lawyers or NGOs, whatever, often didn't consult people properly. They didn't write the constitutions in languages people could understand. They did not establish the institution in a robust manner. And that's partly why they are so weak and dysfunctional, because they've never been, the processes to establish them from the very beginning were very problematic. A big set of problems in restitution, as you all know, I'm sure, are problems in using land productively. There's been a major lack of effective post-settlement support in restitution. Very little in the way of meaningful credit or training or extension advice, transport, ploughing services, veterinary services, access to inputs, and access to markets has been provided. Often people are given a piece of land and said, it's said to them, now get ahead and farm on this farm. But actually, so beneficiaries are often required to step into the shoes of the former white owners of that farm and to continue to manage these farms as one commercial farm. Okay, as one unit, now owned by a group of people. And alternative models, which would involve, for example, subdividing the farm into smaller units, perhaps with some shared grazing, these have never been offered to people by government. But government has not supported the idea of small-scale farming in restitution, or for that matter, in redistribution. So people are now expected to take a farm and run it as a commercial enterprise, even though they might have had no prior experience of managing a commercial farm. They don't have access to loans from the bank. They often don't have the infrastructure. They don't have the connections to the market. And often these enterprises have failed or not done very well. And it's not surprising. So lack of post-settlement support has been a major problem in restitution. Basically, people, in my view, people have been set up for failure. So what we see is this obsession with large-scale commercial farming as the only real viable form of farming. That's what people must do. And government has not taken seriously the idea that there are other scales of farming, other farming systems, other kinds of markets which could have been supported, which people would have been more familiar with, would have given them a better basis on which to start using that land. So in my view, people have been set up for failure. So the impact of restitution on production, on livelihoods, on employment, on productivity has been weak. There are some success stories, but not very many of them. And what we see missing in restitution, but also in land reform more generally, is a small farm developmental path. Okay, some set of policies and programs which support a different scale of farming, which might become more commercial over time, but is more with practically within people's reach. The other big problem is that we've got land policies on this one hand, and we've got agricultural policies on the other hand, and they've not connected up with one another. Agricultural policies tend to support the large-scale commercial sector, whether it be in respect of how markets operate, in respect of markets, for example, export markets, in terms of policies with regard to inputs and so on. Whereas we really have not seen any coherent set of policies to support a small-scale farming option in South Africa. And that's a problem not just in respect of restitution, but much more generally. That is a key weakness in our whole land reform program. So that's something about the old restitution program. Now, in 2014, government passed an amendment to the Restitution of Land Rights Act. Okay, and it extended the period in which claims could be lodged to 2019. So instead of the cutoff being December 1998 and those 80,000 claims having to be resolved, now people are allowed to lodge new claims for another 5 years from 2014. Okay, so what's involved? This has been a very controversial piece of legislation. And it is being challenged in the Constitutional Court, was it last week or the week before? About 10 days ago. So what's going on with this new Amendment Act? So the progress of restitution has been slow. Most rural claims have not been resolved. There's been poor implementation and inadequate support. The budget for restitution has been in decline. There's been very little impact, very little real reduction in rural poverty. What's estimated that if you open up the land claims for another 5 years, government says we anticipate nearly 400,000 new claims to come in as compared to the 80,000 claims we had before. And this could cost, in their own budget, in their own estimate, between 130 and 180 billion rand, which is money that they do not have. At the average rate of resolving claims, it could take, one estimate is 144 years, to complete the program, and another estimate that made it 230 years. If it's been slow to date, if you increase the number of claims to 400,000, when is this program ever going to be resolved? In 140 years' time, what will South Africa look like? We've got no idea. It's not a very realistic target, I don't think. But most of the new claims are actually likely to be for cash rather than for land. In other words, for compensation. And of the 120,000 new claims which have been lodged since the Amendment Act was passed, most of those are actually for asking people asking government for cash compensation. So actually, the new amendment will not really change the distribution of land in the country as a whole. It's actually a way of government providing cash to people. And of course, lots of people, whether or not they have a legitimate claim, say, here's free money. Let's lodge a claim. Okay. What's also happening is that traditional leaders have started lodging new claims, often to vast territories of land based on 19th century tribal boundaries. For example, the Ingonyama, King Goodwill Zwelithini, said, no, we're going to claim the whole of KwaZulu, going back to the 1830 boundaries on behalf of the Zulu nation. Okay, it doesn't have a legal basis for doing that at the moment, but these are the kinds of claims which are coming into the new process. The problem is that it's unclear what will happen to the existing claims, the first round of claims lodged by 1998, if 30,000 of them not resolved. How are these going to be affected by the new claims? What happens if a new claim is lodged on the same land that an old claim was lodged? Which one is resolved? Which takes priority? So there's a lot of problems, and the court challenge to the Amendment Act has asked this question. Government says they're going to prioritize existing claims, but it's unclear how they're going to do that. It's very, very vague. In fact, even the lawyers acting for government couldn't agree amongst themselves what prioritization really meant. The other way the Act is being challenged is because of lack of adequate consultation. It was being pushed through before the 2014 election. It seems to have ulterior motives, other kinds of political reasons for pushing it through to try and get people to vote for the ruling party. But in my view, as my colleagues and I at last have written about this Amendment Act, it is a disaster story. I don't think this is really going to benefit many ordinary South Africans. Even if you get a little bit of cash, it's not going to make a fundamental difference to your life. It is not really land reform. It's a way of buying people off. I think we should not have passed this Act. I do think we need to redistribute land, but I'm not sure that restitution is actually the right way to go. Okay, so there's some debates about restitution. What about redistribution? So partly because of the Constitution, which says that government cannot just take land or other forms of property away from people. It has to do so through the law, and it has to provide compensation for land rights which are expropriated, even though the Constitution allows the payment of that compensation to be at less than market value. Nevertheless, given that constitutional framework, a decision was made that, based on those choices, that the best way to do land redistribution was on a willing buyer, willing seller basis. In other words, government would make offers to landholders to buy that land for redistribution, and a negotiation would take place about the price. He would be a willing buyer in government and a willing seller in the form of the landowner. And for most land acquired for redistribution since 1994, market prices have been paid. And the formula offered in the Constitution of less than market value, what's called just and equitable compensation, has never really been used. Okay? And this is one of the things that the current minister, Mr. Nkwinti, is going to try to make operational. Paying compensation at less than market value, taking the formula in the Constitution into account. And that's partly why he's established the Office of the Valuer General, which will make determinations about prices to be paid for farms acquired in land reform. So willing buyer, willing seller. There have been three different programs, and now four, in fact, different programs of land reform. Between 1995 and 2000, we had something called the Settlement and Land Acquisition Grant, okay, which was paid to individual applicants. Or rather, it was a budget which government allocated to those people who successfully applied for the land redistribution program. So if 100 people, and it was set initially at an amount of 16,000 rand per applicant. So if you had 100 applicants, all applying, all getting 16,000 rand, that would have been 1.6 million. That 1.6 million could have been used to purchase a farm for those 100 people. Okay, that didn't work very well. And in 2000, under a new minister, Mr. Togo Dudiza, FLAG grant was replaced with the LRAD grant, the Land Redistribution for Agricultural Development grant, which was a more flexible grant. It could go up as high as 100,000 rand for the applicants. But the important thing about land redistribution, the LRAD grant, is that it was actually now aimed no longer at the poor, but at the relatively wealthy emerging black commercial farmers. Okay. In 2010, that program was itself had many problems. It was replaced by the Proactive Land Acquisition Strategy, or PLAS, in which case government proactively buys land, buys farms, before they've identified who the beneficiaries are. And then they go around looking for people who might want to use that land. And this proactive land acquisition strategy has been used to, again, privilege emerging black commercial farmers, relatively well-off people, rather than the poor. And again, it's been premised on a commercial farming model, people engaging in large-scale commercial farming. So by 2014, we have 7 million hectares of land transferred through all forms of land reform, that is, including restitution and redistribution and a little bit of tenure reform. That is only 8% of white-owned agricultural land in 20 years. Okay? That's compared to an initial target of 30% in 5 years. So land reform has been much slower than anyone realized it was going to be. It's taking place at a very, very slow pace. So we have to ask the question, why is that? And you'll all have your own answers. But one key problem is that the budget for land reform is small. It's never been more than 1% of the national budget. Never more than 1%. And most recently, it's been about 0.5% of the national budget. It's not had priority for the ruling party. So that's a comparison of these different types of redistribution policies. More recently, since 2013 or 2014, we've had some new policies. The state land lease and disposal policy, which says that people who are getting land through land reform will not get ownership of that land. They will remain, they will get leases from the state. They will pay rent for land that they receive through land reform. This is partly because of the high failure rate of projects. The government is saying, we don't trust you. We don't, you're the beneficiaries, to own this land. You might mess it up. You might sell it. It'll be gone. We're going to offer you, initially it was a five-year lease. Now 30-year leases are being offered, the option of another 20 years. But ownership is no longer transferred to people through redistribution. It's rather people become tenants of the state. The other program is the Recapitalization and Development Program, which is a way of providing funds to the beneficiaries of land reform, the RECAP program. It's now the only form of funding. You know, there are no other grants for land reform beneficiaries, even for restitution. You have to get a RECAP grant, okay? And there are many problems with it. The other policy which has not been properly... put into policy yet is an agricultural land holdings policy, which is going to come before, a law might come before Parliament this year or perhaps next year. And this says that there will be a limit on the amount of hectares, the size of a commercial farm owned by any individual. The government will determine in advance a ceiling on farm sizes in different parts of the country. Okay, what can we say about the recapitalization program? There was a review carried out by the presidency in 2014. Very, very critical. Very large amounts of money going to individuals with not to very good effect. It was particularly problematic in the East and in the Free State, where on average, across the country, individuals are getting 2.9 million rand per project for redistribution. In the Free State, that was 3.9, nearly 4 million rand for an individual. And about 1 million rand per beneficiary, because often these are small family members, small groups of family members. And it's costing 500,000 rand to create one job. And it's a requirement that you have a strategic partner or a mentor. That is somebody who claims to know about farming who will help you make a success of it. That's now a requirement of a recapitalization grant. So it's actually quite problematic. This is a little diagram which sets out how these different policies are related to one another. So the state up in the left-hand corner provides RECAP funds for 5 years and issues a lease to someone getting land through the redistribution program. To get a lease, you need to create a legal entity like a company. You need to have a bank account, a notarial bond, an asset register. You have to get permission for improvement. This was all subject to committees over on the left-hand side who select beneficiaries, allocate leases and funds, assess progress against the business plan, determine leases, and that committee will also determine upper and lower farm size limits in each district. So it's government by committee deciding what people will do on their farms, which they have to lease from government, which they do not get in ownership. On the right-hand side there, you'll see that there's a major role for agribusiness and for white farmers. You have to have mentors or strategic partners or equity shareholders, and you often have to have consultants. And they draw up the business plan for the people getting land. And this projected income in the business plan is what the committees on the left-hand side use to determine whether or not to renew someone's lease. So actually, the farmers have very little power to decide for themselves. They have strategic partners or mentors who are often earning a lot of money from these partnerships on the one hand, and they have government officials and committees on the other deciding for them. So they have very little freedom of maneuver. But it's actually worse than that, because government divides the beneficiaries into these four categories. 1, 2, 3, 4. So number one is black farmers who use a limited amount of land for subsistence, and two, they use a little bit they engage in a little bit of sale of produce. So this is where the large numbers of people are. For these categories of beneficiaries, you'll always have a lease. It will never get transferred to you in ownership. For beneficiaries numbers 3 and 4, categories 3 and 4, medium and large scale commercial farmers, however, you can get ownership after 50 years of following government's recommendations. So this is a very, what I would call, paternalistic system, which gives almost no freedom of maneuver to the farmers themselves. Government will decide for you, and they can basically end your lease and kick you off the farm when they decide that you are not meeting your income targets. This is a very long way from a land redistribution program aimed at redressing dispossession and poverty and trying to address the real roots of poverty and inequality in the country. Okay. A little bit about tenure security, this, as you well know, farm workers have not really benefited from ESTA, and as you might also know, there's a current court case where NGOs and rural communities are taking government to court for not implementing the Land Reform Labor Tenants Act. So there's something like 20,000 labor tenant claims which have sat with nothing happening to them since the late 1990s. And often government has lost the record. So AFRA and the other clients are now taking government to court and saying these people have rights in terms of this law. You have to do something about settling these claims. But these acts have not been terribly effective, and farm workers have continued to lose their rights to live on farms. Around 1 million people have lost access to land on farms, been kicked off farms between 1994 and 2004. By now, it must be up to something like 2 million people. So tenure reform for farm workers has not been at all effective. In response, government, Mr. Nkwinti, has brought the so-called 50-50 policy. She also calls the strengthening relative rights. And it's an idea that you will force all farmers, all commercial farmers, black and white, to give up 50% of the shares in their business. 50% remains the minimum stake for the owner. The other 50% will be divided out amongst the workers on the farm. Okay, so if you've worked for 50 years on the farm, you can get 50% of the 50%. If you've worked for 25 years on the farm, you can get 25% of the 50%. If you've worked for 10%, for 10 years, you can have a share of 10% of the 50%. And there's a little bit available for household subsistence for farm workers. The problem with this proposal is that it's very unclear who's really going to benefit. Actually, farm workers have never asked for shares in the business. And where equity share schemes have been put in place, they haven't worked too well and people are unhappy about it. What farm workers want is better salaries and better working conditions. Actually, there are very few people who have worked for 50 years or more, and not that many have worked for 25 years or more. And actually, if this becomes law, farmers will stop people working on the farm after 10 years and get some new people in. Okay? Actually, if government pays out for 50% of the shares which they've expropriated, that is an injection of money into the farming business. Actually, the farmer is going to get free money with very little real distribution of benefits through shares. The whole scheme doesn't really work. Recently, in the State of the Nation address, Mr. Zuma, the president, announced there were four pilots of this policy. I think white farmers have realized this is a good thing for them, and they're going to make it work for them. Communal tenure, I won't talk about that because you're going to talk a lot about it. But just the so-called wagon wheel, which involves land titling and transfer to traditional councils. I just want to make one point. Firstly, as you know, the outer boundary, the title to the land, goes to the traditional council, who holds that idea is that they will hold that land in private ownership, that is, if the law is passed. But what will happen on the rest of that land? People will continue to use small plots and use communal grazing, but increasingly there will be development financing. You see, investment and development financing coming in from outside companies who are going to want to use that land for big businesses. This is already starting to take place in some parts of the country. Large-scale agricultural enterprises, never mind mining, but for farming, we're going to use this land. And the traditional council, as owner, is empowered to enter into a business arrangement with the investor. This is what the government policy is actually sending us towards. This is, and of course, that's the same model that we see in restitution and redistribution. You do not trust people. You do not give them ownership. You require them to be in partnership with other people with powerful business interests, whether they're strategic partners or mentors, who receive most of the benefits. And people can, the so-called beneficiaries of land reform, can just struggle on, try and make a living for themselves. So my last slide, who benefits from land reform at present? So we saw that we have a history of dispossession. That is the basis for poverty and inequality. So land reform should be benefiting the poor of the country. In fact, the real winners are the elite, relatively better off people, often with businesses that they run, often with political connections. And they are the ones, the emerging black commercial farmers, the agribusiness companies, as well as chief white farmers and consultants. They are the ones who are actually getting their hands on land provided by government. Of course, there's a populist ideology. This is all in, you know, to do with changing the inheritance of unequal land. But if you look in detail, in research, in projects on the ground, at who's benefiting, it is not the poor. It is, in fact, the emerging wealthy elite. It's the BEE beneficiaries who are really benefiting. So state control of land and resources should be to support farmers, but actually it's directing them to business elites.